Everybody, if you're just coming in, come on up to the front, get us all together. Of course, we're going to have things to do. This session is starting over with communication. We have three people up here who are rock stars at this and always make me feel better when I feel like I'm failing because they're like, just keep going, just keep going. It's like Dory, just keep swimming. And so we have Kelly Meissner, Karen Hurst at the very end, and Corey Stell in the middle. And they're going to give us this session, so I'm going to let them do it.
Thank you. Okay, here we go. Thanks, everyone, for joining us. Please come on in and come to the center. We're looking for a nice collaborative opportunity when we can. So if you're coming in the door right now, come on into the center. Don't be shy. We're going to communicate and collaborate together today. Thanks for joining us at Starting Over with Communication. Some of you may have been expecting Erin Sheldon, and she of course sends her regrets that she's not here and asked us to step up in her place. So we're really thrilled to be here. Thank you. We're really thrilled to be here and have, yes, Lily Grace, awesome. We're really thrilled to be here and have this opportunity to share and collaborate with you because you're all in a safe space with like-minded people who have tried things and struggled, and we're going to get through this together. I'm going to start off with a quick land acknowledgement because this is something that's really important to me. I live in Canada, and the Indigenous peoples of Canada have suffered really great turmoil over eons of time. I think that's something that us in a disabled community can actually appreciate because something else that happened in Canada was the residential schools for Indigenous children, and then there was also hospital schools for disabled children. And it's really sensitive topic for us in Canada, and we are dealing with our reconciliation and how we can actually give back what has happened to these people. So it's really important to me that we acknowledge that we're gathering here in this space on the lands of the Wyandot, Seneca, Erie, and Huron nations. Thanks. So we're going to start this off by saying, let's be totally honest, not being able to speak totally sucks, right? It's one of the hardest things that we experience. Not being able to speak is really hard for all of us to do. So what we're looking at talking about today is trying to give you some ideas of where we're all at and how we can actually move forward to make a difference. If you're in this room or you're just joining us now, you've probably tried with different AAC systems or tried different types of communication. You may have had great moments of success and others that are not so much successful. So we're here to do a massive think tank in 30 minutes to try and make sure everybody feels comfortable and knows that they can take steps forward.
Yeah. So Kelly got at this a little bit, but I just want to acknowledge briefly who we're anticipating is in the room with us right now. So we think we're looking out on a room of people that your families have an AA system that is in place already. You've been working hard over time to support your loved one on their communication journey, including AAC, and you may have gone through waves that have been like rock star and you feel like you're totally on it and in the zone, and other periods where it's harder and you're feeling stuck. And that stuckness is what we're coming together to talk about today, and some tips on how we can get through yesterday's stuckness and move forward together. So if that doesn't reflect who you are or where you're at, you're totally welcome to stay with us today. But if you don't yet have an AAC system in place, we really, really, really encourage you to check out the Stepping Into AAC session later today and those resources from that program that are on the ASF website. Yeah.
Perfect. Thank you so much. I'm so glad that we have such a big group of lots of different people. It's really important, especially for our people living with Angelman syndrome. You are amazing experts at this, and we are following your lead. So thank you for participating with us today. So our focus is we may have been stuck, and we got to figure out how to get unstuck. And that's happened definitely to me for sure, and I think these two ladies are going to agree with me. It's something that we've all experienced. So in a moment, we're going to do a pair prayer and share. And the reason we're going to do that is because we want to give you a moment to really talk to other people, see what your experience has been with AAC or any type of communication and how that's actually gone for your family. I'll tell you that for our family, my daughter's name is Kate. She has had access to a system since 2012, and it comes and goes, and it's in waves, and we're in a really, really hard spot right now. So while I'm up here leading this session, this was the number one session I wanted to attend as an attendee, because I really need it. And being able to collaborate with each other and get ideas is what we really need to do. So we'd like you to really take a moment to unload about your communication experiences with a neighbor. So that might be, you might have to move close by to someone or lean over. Unload about your experiences and share about your stuckness. How did you get stuck? What are you stuck on? We'll take a quick moment to do that. Hi, welcome. If you're just coming in, we're just doing a quick sharing moment about our experiences. So have a seat, feel free to get collaborative, and we're just sharing about where we're stuck on our AAC. If you're just joining us, feel free to come on in. We're just talking a quick moment about our experiences with communication and how we've gotten stuck. Where are we stuck? And acknowledging that is really important. Because it's good for your heart and it's good for your soul. We're going to give you just one more minute to share your ideas. So if you haven't had a chance to share your story or unload some of that stuckness, please take a moment to do that. Find someone. You're in a room with friends who understand and get it. These are your people. All right, everybody, we're just going to draw your attention right up back here, if you don't mind. That would be fantastic. Probably lots of common themes that have come out. Definitely something that we have all experienced is having really good surges of excellent communication and then seeing it kind of plateau or back off a little bit. I think some of the biggest parts of where people get stuck is definitely that we feel like we've got to have a perfect system and that we're not using it well enough, or we're failing at some point. We really want to try and give ourselves the grace to not feel like we failed, because even bringing in a communication system to your lives is such a game changer. You are making such a huge difference for your family and for your person who lives with Angelman syndrome. We've had ebbs and flows ourselves. We've had really great success. And some of those moments of big success are the massive multimodal communication skills that people with Angelman syndrome traditionally show really well. And it's unbelievable when you see that. And it's hard to feel like, okay, why would I make my son or daughter replicate that when through a device when they're already identifying it? So sometimes that's where we can end up a little bit stuck. It's really important that you recognize that using a communication device will never be as good as speech. The technology that is currently out there, while amazing and while we're really all excited about it, it will never capture the nuances of speech. Something that I really resonated with while I was midway on this journey and feeling really stuck and really guilty, somebody said to me, the technology is the barrier. It's not your kid. The technology is totally the barrier. The technology will never catch up with the natural ability of what it is to actually have traditional verbal speech. And so take a moment to appreciate that that's a big deal. You're trying your best with a system that is capturing a tiny, a minutia amount of communication. And that's a hard thing for you to do. This isn't a problem that is ours or our loved ones living with AS. So our people living with Angelman syndrome in the room, I want you to really feel that this isn't your fault either. Getting stuck isn't your fault. There's lots of barriers that are in place, and we're here to help try and figure those out. Using AAC is not natural. It's not something that we come to really easily, right? Like you can see me right now waving my arms around and using typical verbal speech. That's very different than what we expect from our AAC users when they're communicating on a device. It makes sense that we stumble, and it makes sense that we get stuck. Everybody who's in this room with you right now is right there with you. We all get it. That's why we wanted to take this moment to do this pair and share, to give you a moment to understand and appreciate that you're amongst friends, you're amongst family, and the people who can support you. So we're here to help give you some ideas of how we can get unstuck. Karen?
So part of getting unstuck is letting go of the stuff we gotta let go of. So if you're gonna hang with us here, I'm gonna ask you to go in with us all the way on this, and we're gonna actually shake off our stuckness together. And then we're going to go and spend the rest of our time together talking about actual strategies for how we get unstuck, right? What can we do today? So, because we know that yesterday is not today, so that's really good news, right? Today can be a new day where we can try different things, get unstuck in different ways. So here's how this goes. Stand as you're able, find a little space around yourself. I'm gonna make sure I don't fall off this thing by coming down. Okay, so here's what we do. We are gonna shake off our whole body, all of our energy, and the way it goes is we're gonna start, and we're gonna do a countdown. So we're gonna start with our right arm up in the air, and we're gonna shake our right arm 5 times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then you're gonna shake your left arm 5 times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Get that right leg out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Get that stuckness out. 1, left leg. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then we're gonna repeat it. We're gonna count down. We're gonna go 4 times on our right arm, 4 times left, 4 times right leg, 4 times left leg. We're gonna do a countdown all the way to 0. It's gonna get faster and faster as we go. We're gonna get all of our stucks out so we can look at what we're gonna do today. Okay, ready for 4? Okay, here we go. One, two, three, four. Left leg, one, arm, one, two, three, four. Right leg, one, two, three, four. Left leg, one, two, three, four. Right arm, one, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, 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 one. And now, congratulations. You get a certificate. You're officially unstuck. We're starting over. And we're going to talk about what we can do now.
Amazing. Thanks, Karen. That's really great. And I definitely feel like that solved a lot of my issues. So there we go. Unloading everything in one moment with people that know and get it is really meaningful. So thanks for doing that with us today. You're such brave, good participants. Awesome. Really, really important that we don't need to do all of this today. Oh, I should switch my slide. We don't need to do all of this stuff today, and we can't do all of the stuff today, like meaning in the current moment. And there are lots of ways to do something, lots of ways for us to move forward. We're gonna look at three ways that we kind of came up with together that really resonated with all of us. So we want you to think about, like, yesterday, the issue was my kid's not interested. This is probably one of the most common things, right? My kid's not interested. An actual research actually from AssistiveWare is actually showing that the Angelman population is trying at least on average 4 different systems before they kind of get settled. And probably lots of us have been there. Oh, it's not working. They're not engaged. So I'm going to try something else. And that really kind of leaves you in this spot where you have to feel like you're keep going. So our suggestion is that was yesterday. Your kid's not interested is what you felt. Today, you're going to use your child's communication system to talk about the things they care about. So that might mean, right, Katie? That might mean you model what you can handle. Maybe it's likes and dislikes, or maybe it's what's happening next. Pick something and give that a try. You know if what your person with Angelman syndrome likes and doesn't like. That would be an easy step for you to do right now, right? To model something right now on their device and just say, I like, or I think you like, pick something, whatever. It's an or tell them what's happening next, because I hear lunch break is next. So that wouldn't be a bad idea, right? To tell them one thing that you can do or model right now. So start talking about the things that they care about. Don't worry if they don't seem to be paying attention. This is a really big deal. I've seen this not only with our AAC users, but I've also seen it as a high school physics teacher. And I'm gonna tell you a quick little story of one of my students I saw in grade 11 physics, because this is in a class that would have been streamed for academic success. And I had a student that always put his head down on his desk. And I'm like, what is he doing? I didn't know how to engage with him. It was a little, I was struggling, right? And this was like probably 12 years ago. And on his first assessment, he did awesome. He got like a 95. And I'm like, whoa. When I handed that assessment back to this kid, his name was Terry. Name is Terry. I said, Terry, I didn't know you were listening. And he's like, I always listen to you, Mrs. Meisner. And so at that moment, I realized that he's putting his head down to try and focus on the information that's being presented to him and trying to absorb it. And that is super meaningful, because I was like, oh, light bulb moment. That's actually my kid, right? That's totally what's happening when I feel like Kate's not listening. It doesn't mean I give up. It means I keep trying and make sure that I power through it. It might also be that the reason they seem like they're not paying attention is because they could have an access issue. And one of those access issues might be sight. They might not be able to see what they're actually looking at. So we're really grateful that Dr. Karen Erickson is here today and doing actual information and a study about how CVI, cortical vision impairment, relates to Angelman syndrome. So make sure you take advantage of the spot. I think there's still some opportunity to sign up for that. Some other ideas are to keep it light, fun, and simple. So it's like not stressful, right? It's okay to think about you in this process. Keep it light and fun and simple. Share your opinions on the things that they like and they don't like. and say what you think they might be saying without words. So that term of multimodal communication, I'm assuming all of you in this room have heard that term many times. We see that happening when we see the multimodal communication or some kind of effort on our from our people with Angelman syndrome to show what they know or tell us what they know through multiple different ways with their bodies, we're going to acknowledge that. So we can say something like, oh, I think you're trying to show me this. Or I'll say, Kate, I wonder if it's you think it's time for bath. Maybe we can look at having bath time earlier. Like, those are the kinds of things that you want to do. Attribute meaning, really understanding, showing them that any type of communication is valid is super, super important. So as I'm waving my arms around here, as you can see, I'm a hand talker. That's part of my multimodal communication. That's part of my body language. We all do it. We all do it. So let's use that as an effective strategy to help us move forward. So today, you're going to use your child's communication system to talk about the things they care about.
Corey's next. Thank you. Can you do the,
Another feeling or experience that we shared, the three of us, as we were thinking about the obstacles that we face, is feeling like we don't have enough time to integrate or use AAC, and just simply being too overwhelmed, whether it's by AAC or the AAC system itself or life. When Karen and I'm not going to disclose what we shared, but when we were talking about our obstacles, a lot of it was all these other things that are going on in our lives right now that like take everything that we have. And so figuring out how to still use an AAC system and keep that alive is really, really hard when we're focused on medical issues or other school issues or that sort of thing. And that is real. And that is yesterday. I don't have enough time. Time is a very precious resource. And today, when I'm starting fresh, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to say one thing to Lily Grace, or maybe just in front of Lily Grace, that's my daughter, just in front of Lily Grace to her dad using the AAC system. And then you can go back to what Kelly talked about to think about what those things might be. But if I just set a goal for myself, and I have done this before when I needed a reboot, is like, I'm just gonna make sure I get to that AAC system one time today and say something. And it might be a comment, or it might be that verbal referencing, or you know what I see Lily Grace doing, trying to reflect that back using her AAC system. And I'm just going to try to do one thing. And sometimes that is the only thing I end up doing that day with the AAC. And I really try to just pat myself on the back for that, because I showed up. And oftentimes when I do the one thing, it becomes easier to do a second thing and a third thing, and to keep moving in the given day that that I got up and I did the thing. And so I would say, before we move on to the next slide, is to really like just start small and know that like that really is okay. I think we sometimes feel like if I'm not modeling everything all day long, all the different functions, then what's the point? And so there's some expression that I'm probably going to get wrong that's like, don't let perfect be the enemy of the good or good enough, but just try to do that one small thing and see where that leads you.
So the last thing, and then we want to hear from you about other strategies that you, other things that you're struggling with, is I can't get any support. Yesterday I said I can't get any support. Maybe that's the school team that's not great. Maybe that's your kids out of school and they're an adult and they don't, there's no services. You can't get anybody to help you figure this out. And it feels really overwhelming, right? It's a lot. And you can't get the people to pay attention to what you're trying to raise or how you're trying to lift it up. And today, later on today, actually, at 3:45, you can take that next step by going to this session on stepping into AAC that Tabby and Rachel, who are here in the room with us now, are going to be leading. And so that's like, you can say today is a new day and today I'm going to do this next step, right? And that's the next thing that we can do when you can't get any support, is look to our community here. The resource that we have in stepping into AAC is an incredible resource that is a gift to the entire community of non-speakers and the people who love them, because It is a very bite-sized, like Corey said, really easily accessible for grown-ups and other support folks to sort of take in chunks and just have little bits to help us start on this journey and get us going. So I want to hear from other people. What are other things that have got you stuck? What are other ways that you are in the yesterday? And we'll come to you with a mic. All right, I'll come to you, Nico. Just a minute, Nick. I'll be there in a second. I'm going to come to Michelle first.
Hi, I'm Michelle. Jake Slater is my child. He's 21. But the one thing that got me sort of unstuck is just putting his device on him. I mean, he can't say anything if it's not there. And convincing everyone, my husband, all the care providers, everybody to put it on. And guess what? He started using it. So just put it on him.
Okay. What else are you getting stuck with?
I am getting stuck because Sophie had good use of Pod when she was younger, and then COVID and school switches and all this other stuff, and they've blown it up. I don't know, do I go back to Pod, which at the time she was even saying not enough words, but she can't have something too complex, or do I pick a new AAC program to go forward with since it's all blown up anyway? And this is literally paralyzing us.
So I just want to take a minute and like acknowledge the paralysis that happens, because it is overwhelming and it feels like we are making a choice that is about what can our kid say and not say. And that's for real overwhelming, grief-inducing, and often just not acknowledged as part of what we're dealing with as parents and caregivers, right? And I know when I've been there, I feel terrible. And the two things that I know also is that we've got each other and we've got this amazing Angelman community that is supporting each other, and we're gonna figure it out together. And we've got some incredible professionals. And when we chose a system back 10 years ago, I chose the system that was the easiest for me to navigate because I had 6-month-old twins at home in addition to a 2-year-old kid with Angelman syndrome. That was how I made the choice. And now I'm like 10 years later, is that the right choice? I don't know. Kelly, what would you add to this? And then I have to go say hi to Nico.
It's not right. Sorry, Karen, thank you. Thank you, Becky. Wow, that is a big deal. And I know what Aaron Sheldon's answer is to that. It is to use what you have. And it's really, really hard. So I know that we experienced the exact same thing. I felt desperate when the school kind of, I'm going to say let us down, because I felt like when we were during shutdowns during COVID, we were rocking it, which was our moment of like super awesome. And that was thanks to Kate Ahern leading us through some really awesome stuff. We were doing great, but it all fell apart when it goes back to the school. And then I desperately am clinging to, oh, maybe I should switch to the grid version of Pod. Maybe I should switch to the assistive wares version. And like, I'm desperately trying to figure out what I need to do. Aaron's advice is always just use what you've got, because they're all doing the similar kind of stuff. There's not like one of them, LAMP, ProloQuota Go, Pod, Touch Chat. It's not like one is better than the other. You're providing your loved one with robust communication, and that's a big deal, and that is more than enough. But that's big grief, Becky, and I totally feel it. We all feel it. It is big grief, because it's one more area that we feel like we've let somebody down, and that's really hard as parents. It's really hard as carers. So Aaron would say, stick with it and go back to that Pod. Yeah, because that's what was accessible to you, and that was accessible to Sophie. And that's what you know, especially if you've done some training in that area. That's what you know. Kate says, yes, Becky, go back to Pod. Yeah.
Other questions, comments? We have 1 minute left.
My question is, my daughter loves her iPad, but for entertainment, and it is the joy, and it is her favorite thing in the world. And we've tried different communication apps on it, but she only wants it to be for fun, and how you don't want to take that away, and how do you ever make that transition over to that it also communicates for you?
That's a great question. Well, I have an idea too. What?
Yes. Kate's holding up two iPads over there.
I'm gonna give you the mic so everybody can hear you.
Being dedicated really helped. And then once she got to, all right, this is our voice on her Nova Chat. We have the app on her iPad. And for me, when she's at home watching YouTube, if she really wants something, she will exit and go to the app because she knows it's there. But like for us, it really was, we had to dedicate this iPad. So we had two iPads for a long time. This was the means. Then we got a device. This was the device. There, you know, there was nothing else. And then she learned to switch between them.
I think that's a great idea. Another idea I have is one of the things that Nico does a lot is goes into his photo album, right? As sort of like a step to AAC system is like, how do you start to show that there's a photo album that you can use, or what kind of app you can get on the device you have to sort of help to bridge, right? And offer some ways of getting your people into it.
Thank you. I would also suggest, like, I'm super excited that ASF partnered with Safe Place Bedding. So, can I use your bag as a model? Thank you. This is a big deal, seeing this on this bag. Like, I actually get shivers seeing this on this bag. So when you need to, go light tech. It's okay. Go to a core board, go to light tech. That might be the way to get her back. I can see her using her iPad, loving it for other things, right? So that might be a losing battle for you, and that's okay. Go light tech. We can build books out of these things. I know that AssistiveWare has a pod program that you can actually edit on the iPad and then print, because that's what we've all been looking for. How many of us have built pod books? Oh my goodness. We've been looking for that facility to make it a little bit easier to print right off of what you've got on the iPad into a light tech book. So go light tech. It doesn't have to be complicated. This is awesome. Right? Something that's going to get you going to communicate is amazing. And I just like to take a moment right now to appreciate that we are standing on the shoulders of giants. That's like one of my favorite references to Isaac Newton because I'm a physics teacher. But we are standing on the shoulders of giants. There are people who have come before us who have carved the way. Aaron Sheldon is one of them. Mary Louise Bertram is another. Kate Ahern is another. Siobhan Sargent is another. We have worked really hard to get to this spot, but we have followed the path that others have opened the door for. So if you need support, you can reach out. All of those Angelman groups, and I'm actually going to make this suggestion because I actually have a bunch of old iPads sitting at home. And because we just, you know, we've gone to the updated model or whatever, la la la. Put in one of the ASF groups, even this one, say, hey, I'm looking for an old iPad that can just run a communication system. I have a couple of minis that might take an older communication system on the operating system and work. So people might be able to share stuff, especially if that money is a barrier. But Corey's going to give us a reminder, Corey's going to give us a reminder about where else you can access support for iPads.
So two thoughts. One is also about the core boards. I think, is this right? I'm looking at our stepping into AAC friends, that there are free like core boards available. So if your child has an AAC system and you know what symbol program it is, there are core boards that are free and available to print out that will have this likely have the same symbol set that you're using on your AAC system, and you just download and print them. And then the other thing I wanted to mention, because it can be really challenging to have more than one iPad, is the ASF Family Fund. And so we can all apply for funds from ASF. It opens up two times a year, and get funds to purchase an iPad that you could then use as a dedicated device for AAC. And I think Becky's here to take the mic away from us.
No, yeah? I just wanted to say,
you guys are also kind. Thank you so much. We want you to remember that this AAC business is hard. It's one of the hardest things I've ever done because it feels so unnatural. So you are not alone. We're all in this together, and it's okay to share that things aren't going well. I think you see a lot of how amazing things are going for people, and that just pushes you down heavier. It's a heavy push. It's oppressive, right? And you can feel that power. So make sure that it's okay to share some of those hard moments, because people are out here to support you. There are lots of great people that can do that. There will continue to be good days and harder days. That's reality, and that is life. And life is often gets in the way. You know what? No, please know that what you're doing is good enough. Actually, it's more than good enough. Having a system is more than good enough. You are leaps and bounds ahead by just being here. Starting over is better than giving up. Oh gosh, I've heard this saying before. Imperfect practice is better than perfection. So you're not looking for perfection. We don't have to get this right. It doesn't have to be perfectly done. Imperfect practice is way better. Way better. Please know that we love you all, and you are awesome, and we are so grateful for you being here. Thank you so much. Thank you, Corey and Karen, for joining me. It's lunchtime, friends, right? Lunchtime. If you have any questions, feel free to come and have a chat with us. We're happy to share and learn from all of you as well. Thank you.